Heavenly Father, thank you for all the gifts that you give us. Thank you so much for the blessing of faith, for the blessing of our faith. Thank you that we can call you Father, and we can relax and trust that you love us, that you watch over us, that you sustain us, that you take care of us, that you never, ever, ever leave us. Thank you for the gift of humor in our lives. Thank you for the gift of divine humor as you deal with us humans. We ask you to bless us and be with us, to pour forth the Holy Spirit in great abundance tonight on our gathering. Open our minds that we might know your will and inflame our hearts that we might do it. We place our cares, our concerns, our difficulties, our struggles, our joys, our triumphs, our whatevers. We place all of it in the hands of Mary, our mother, and we pray together, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady, star of the new evangelization, St. Thomas the Apostle,
pray for us.
St. Elizabeth Ann Seton,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I just got the sign from the back. So I'll try to move this along as best I can. How many people here are Cub fans? That's okay, that's good. How many are not Cub fans? We'll pray for you. We'll pray for you. God bless you. Well, thanks for coming tonight. It's great to see so many familiar faces, some newer than others, some that I feel like go way back. Is it okay if I start off with telling you guys a little something about religious orders? You know, different religious orders, priests are kind of like differentiated by the letters after their name. So if you had like a Franciscan, it would look like that. If you had a Jesuit, it would be like that, the Society of Jesus. If you had a Dominican, it would look like that. The Order of Preachers, those two letters would go after his name. Well, the religious orders are always fighting with each other over resources, over who's smarter, over who's more evangelical, over who does more good for the church. And so once they just got so embroiled in this battle, they decided they would write a letter to God. And they said, Dear God, we want to know which religious order is the best one. We want to know definitively. And so they went to the incenser on the altar, and they burnt the letter, and the ashes went up to God. And then a few hours later, they saw this letter come down. And it landed on the altar. And it said, My dear sons, stop fighting. It is so unchristian. All religious orders are equal. Sincerely, God, comma SJ. I'm Jesuit trained, so I kind of, but you could see how you could substitute any letter there. Okay, thanks again for coming. I like to kind of start out with a little icebreaker so you can get to know the people around you a little bit and have a deep and serious theological discussion. So with the people around you, feel free to introduce yourself for a couple minutes, but answer this question and we're going to bring our findings back together as a whole group. And don't just write it off, because we're a group here tonight that likes to laugh, but talk about this for a second. Did Jesus laugh. Go. Conundrum already?
Yes.
Did we solve this theological problem already?
Yes.
What are, as theologians, what are your findings?
Yes.
He laughed.
Yes.
And you know that.
Yes.
Why? Because the Bible says so, right?
No.
Oh, well then you're just making it up. He was human. Ergo, every human laughs. And cries. Some more than others. Because he was human, he had to laugh. He made us. He made us, so he's got to... Did anyone say no? Yeah. Thank you. Should we all boo or... No, just kidding. Why do you think no?
I've never, ever heard him laughing at all. In fact, I don't think they laughed back in those days.
Right? Okay, well, we know that like the Victorian era, laughter was very, very vulgar. If you look at the rule of Saint Benedict, you know, who the like the founder of Western monasticism, who really wrote down the very first rule book for monks, in several places, like 20 places, he spells out, laughter is very unbecoming of the monk. Monks should not be laughing. Doesn't mean they didn't. What could it actually mean? That they laugh too much, right? So, but we're in general agreement, Jesus laughed, huh? Yeah. Now, I think he did too, okay? But theologically or historically speaking, the case has been made that he didn't. And so I kind of want to start out by talking about that just a little bit. The only reason we would question it is it would seem that his messianic mission was serious business. Does that make sense? So come on, are you really a random sample of all of Christian history in this room? Probably not. Because we all came to a talk entitled The Theology of Humor. So we're bent in that direction. We like to laugh. We like to have a good time. The bulletin article said, please come ready to laugh, right? So if you're the kind of person that's like, ugh, laughter has no business in Christianity, you probably didn't come, unless you came to heckle. And that would be funny in itself. So you see the problem. It's a vicious cycle. But anyway, the case has been made that because his messianic mission, that is, because saving the human race was such serious business, that he was single-minded, that he was about his father's business, that he didn't have this slapstick sense of laughter, right? And so I think that's actually carried over. Now, I'm just speaking about people I know, okay? This never happened to me. Ever. But you could imagine the contemporary seminarian who has a sense of humor, who likes to play jokes, who likes to joke around, getting in lots of trouble in the seminary because a sense of humor can be mistaken as a lack of a seriousness of purpose. You follow me? You could get the idea that religious superiors would look at guys and be like, well, he's always kidding around. He doesn't take anything seriously. How could he be a priest, right? And sometimes if we pulled the secular culture out there and we talked to them, what is a saint like? You know, those of us in this room, maybe we know some saint stories, or maybe we know very holy people who like to joke around, who like to have a good time. But if you're not inside the walls of the church, couldn't you imagine some people out on the street telling us, well, they're very serious people, right? They're very holy people. They take life seriously. God is serious business. You know where I'm coming from with that? Can everybody hear me okay? Even in the back? That's the nicest thing anybody's ever said to me. So there is this sense in which Catholicism is serious business. I mean, think of the last 15 years. I don't even want to say the words out loud, but just think of what the church in the United States of America, the church in Ireland, the scandals we've been through, the problems we've had. There's a way in which we could look at this whole mess of the world today and school shootings. And I don't think St. Thomas is representative, but if you look at diocesan or national numbers, parishes are declining, people aren't getting married, babies aren't being baptized, collections are going down, people aren't entering the priesthood, we almost have no nuns left, right? There's a way in which we could look at that and go, golly, this is dismal, this is serious stuff. Right. And there's kind of been a little trickiness in talking about the humor of Jesus ever since the Council of Nicaea. I have a theory why. Nobody else agrees with it, but maybe you will. The Council of Nicaea was called because the Christian Empire was being torn apart. Because if you would believe it or not, people back then really, really cared about debated theological issues. So we had this problem in the church. Have you guys been following the synod on the family at all? Have you read any articles about, uh-oh, here it comes, this thing is going to rock the Catholic Church? Okay, well, I don't agree with it, but if you magnify that by 40 kajillion, it would be this scandal, okay? It was the scandal of no ink in the markers. You know, it's St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, all our markers work. It was the scandal of Arianism. So if you look at the Bible and you look at scriptural texts, it does leave us kind of hanging a little bit. There are certain points where Jesus says things like, "The Father is greater than I." Right? And I'm here to do the will of my Father. So some Christians who wanted to be very faithful began looking at those scriptural texts and saying, well, if Jesus himself says, if the guy who died and came back to life says, the Father is greater than I, we must take him at his word, right? And he's probably speaking truthfully. So there's got to be God. And then just like half a step below that would have to be like God light. Or as the high school kids I taught at Marion would say, God, but like the free version of an app. You know, just the same game, but just not just quite as good. God light. Or I think the way we would think about it is kind of like now how we view the Blessed Virgin Mary, the singular boast of the human race, the highest among created persons. That's kind of the way they viewed Jesus. The best humanity had to offer, maybe with some divine qualities, some divine attributes, but not quite fully God. And so people started duking it out. And this will blow your mind. Arian Christians were the majority of Christians in the ancient world. Okay? So when St. Augustine was bishop, you've heard of St. Augustine before? He lived in a city, Hippo, and he had a tiny little congregation of Christians who believed that Jesus was God. And in that very same city, there was another bishop and lots of Christians who believed that he was God-like. So this kind of blows our minds. We never think about this, but St. Augustine was the minority group of actual Christians in the ancient world. And they were duking it out. So, I mean, now we know there's two things good, wholesome people don't talk about. Politics, and they didn't have that in the 4th century. They went to work, and they'd be like, so instead of being like, so, how about those Broncos? They would be like, so, how about that divinity of Christ, huh? And that's what they would talk about around the water cooler, and they'd get very embroiled about it. And so the emperor began to see his empire getting into conflict over this religious issue. So he said, okay, bishops of the world, I don't care what you decide, but get together and get your act together, and we need to figure out what the deal is here. So they got together, and of course the bishops knew Jesus was really God, perfect God and perfect man. And so they got together, and because so many Christians, the majority were emphasizing the humanity and not the divinity of Jesus, the bishops came out so strong at the Council of Nicaea in 325, talking about the divinity of Jesus. And I believe ever since, we've been a little bit gun-shy about emphasizing his humanity, because we don't, he's totally other, he's totally God, he's going to come back on clouds and judge us, he is certainly Lord. So we just get a little bit gun-shy about emphasizing his brotherliness, his humanity, and I think part of that would be his laughter, his sense of humor, or if you're from the East Coast, his sense of humor. Also, at the same time, those first Christians, when we were writing down some foundational beliefs, you have to remember, we're getting persecuted. So, are you Christian? Yes, I am. Then we're killing you, right? So, I believe they had a distinct sense of humor that got them, which is what is precisely what got them through those times, but there wasn't really time to write it down or to write any really early Christian treatises on the virtue of humor. You mopping up what I'm spilling? You okay with that so far? Yeah. So I sort of think that's why it's absent in scriptural texts and then those first couple centuries of Christianity. Okay. Pope Francis reminds us the gloomy Christian is a contradiction in terms. And the Christian should not look like he's just returned from a funeral. Those are not an Irish funeral, but a different one. Teresa of Avila said, "What would become of us if everyone endeavored to bury the little bit of humor and wit she has? Do not imitate those unfortunate people who, as soon as they have acquired a little piety, put on a gloomy and peevish air and seem to be afraid of speaking for fear that their piety will fly away." St. Teresa of Avila said, "A sad nun is a bad nun." And St. Teresa of Avila said, "I'm more afraid of one unhappy nun than a whole crowd of evil spirits." Have you ever been around an unhappy nun? It's pretty scary. It's pretty scary, yeah. Along with that, we have to remember there's an objective attractiveness to holiness. So St. Teresa of Avila has kind of given us the funny one-liners on the negative side of things. But on the positive side, there's an objective attractiveness to holiness. And that's important to remember when we get really gung-ho about our religion. So if we are the family member that loves Jesus and loves being Catholic, and we've been on 9 cursillos as participants and even more as leaders or whatever, and we just love our faith so much, and our family members are going, "I just can't handle the holidays with her." We might actually want to take a look in the mirror. You know, oftentimes we say, "My wife just doesn't get it. I finally got on board with this religion. My husband just doesn't understand. Why can't he be where I am with my faith? I know what I need to do. I just need to explain to him perfectly over and over again why he should be going on this retreat weekend with me." And you sit down and you formulate these great arguments, but that numbskull, he's so thick-headed, it just doesn't get through. There's an objective attractiveness to holiness. When we're close to God and we're really living out our faith, it sort of just smells like roses around us, and people sniff that. They catch a whiff and they go, "What's up with her? What's up with that guy? Why is she always so happy? Why is he always in a good mood?" Right? They never say, "You know, once she beat me over the head with Catholicism for the 79th time, I finally got it." There's an objective attractiveness to holiness. Now, I do want to clarify that. Sin is a gunk. It's a scum. It's filth. and it does kind of tarnish our souls. It builds up obstacles, and so sometimes we can see a certain type of holiness and be repulsed by it. That's not what I'm talking about. When we sort of live this joyful Christianity that Pope Francis, that St. Teresa of Avila, that Jesus lived, people take a liking to that naturally. Does that make sense? Questions, comments, concerns, arguments, difficulties, private things you want to discuss in a public forum? Okay, I'll keep going. Cardinal Casper reminds us one of the biggest problems with contemporary Christianity is that we have left humor out of the equation and we take Christianity too seriously. I do think this is the case. I remember in seminary there was a movement beginning of guys who were very serious about, you know, you can joke around a little bit in life, but there's no place for humor in the Mass. You know, so certainly not during the Eucharistic prayer. I would never advocate that. And you know, there's even some guys who like start every Mass off with a joke or end every Mass with a joke. You can think what you want about that. I remember when I first became a priest, it was like my first weekend. You can imagine you're a little bit nervous in like a church that seats 1,300. And I remember this one lady came up and was like, "Father, you need to smile more when you say Mass. Get a sense of humor." I remember thinking, "Lady, if you could just tell that to my seminary faculty." I just spent 5 years trying to convince them my sense of humor would be okay. And it hurt. But I always thought about like what that, you know, "Father, smile more." What does that actually look like? You know, people that say that, have you really thought that through with like, "Bless and approve our offering. Make it acceptable to you." You know, so like just be aware of what you're asking for with that. But anyway, there was this little posse in seminary that was like, even the homily time has no place for laughter. You know, this is a cultic act, this is a serious prayer, and there shouldn't be any laughter even in the homily. They would be shocked to be a liturgy nerd and discover, I know this doesn't help anybody in the back, but it makes me feel better. In Baroque Catholicism, in Europe, there was what was called the Risus Paschalis, the Easter laugh. And so during the Easter season, every time the priest preached, he had to tell a joke or he had to tell a funny story that would get the congregation laughing. Since Easter was such a time of joy and happiness and resurrection and light and life, he had to make the congregation laugh. You know, this is like Latin Mass Catholicism, everybody, like 400, 500 years ago. The Risus Paschalis. So laughter has really, for quite some time, been a part of our liturgical worship. Any Cubs score yet? People don't want to know?
Yes.
Are people like DVRing it and you want to?
Yeah.
Okay, so don't say. Don't say. Sorry. What is humor exactly? Now, I think you could take like a collegiate philosophy course on humor and you could come up with all definitions. For the Christian, humor is a realistic optimism. Okay? And realistic and optimism, I believe, have to go together. Because you can be very realistic without any optimism. Turn on the news. You could also be very optimistic without being real. You know, turn on Lifetime, whatever. But humor at its core is a realistic optimism. It's a characteristic of love. Love and humor go hand in hand. So Christian humor is never divisive, it's never mean, nobody suffers from humor, there's no mockery in humor, And Monsignor Hermes and I always think of the example of Monsignor Tom Bales. He's helping out in Cary now, actually, but he's a longtime priest of our diocese. He's been a priest like 40 years or so. Wonderful, wonderful priest and a hilarious guy. We just had a deanery meeting, all the priests of the McHenry Deanery up in Johnsburg today, and Monsignor Bales was there. He had us all laughing, the whole meeting, the whole dinner. And whenever you're around Monsignor Bales, nobody ever feels like the butt of the joke, right? He's got that wonderful gift of humor that can keep everybody up, everybody light, but nobody suffers from it. That's a great example of Christian humor. Proverbs 9:12 says, "The mocker," the one who mocks, you know a mocker? The mocker is a fool. Jeremiah 20:7-8 says, "The scoffer of God responds with ridicule." So when you make fun of somebody else, you're actually scoffing at God. It's God you're offending. "Those who laugh at others shall collapse," says a book of the Bible I didn't write down. And the 1945 guide, so when I was like getting all my books and stuff for this little talk and reading about humor, I saw this one book, the 1945 Guide for Effective Public Speaking. And I was like, oh, that'll be funny, just because, you know, here's how you give a good speech in 1945. And it says humor is like dynamite, right? So you can like use it well and blow up a mountain so trains can go through it, or you can use it and kill a whole village. Right? Humor is the same way. You can use it effectively and just make a room the happiest room on the planet, or you can seriously kill some spirits. Humor, and this is important for us to remember tonight, okay? Humor is not slapstick. Humor is not happiness. Humor is not being funny. Humor is not mere laughter. Humor is not cynicism. Humor is not satire. Humor is not wit, because the devil has wit. He does not have humor. Got it? Again, love is a characteristic of humor. It brings people together. It's optimistic. It never hurts. Humor has no buts. In all humor, there is some truth, and there has to be, right? So this is like quasi-philosophy right now, okay? So if humor is optimistic realism or realistic optimism, it's kind of a perspective on reality, right? And so there has to be truth in humor, because if you have a false perspective of existence, then you're not really getting God, who is existence itself. Does that make any sense? Okay. So God is, we're getting deep now, right? God is being itself, right? You with me? Yeah, God is being itself, we got that. So God is truth, right? Any falsehood in God?
No.
Can Jesus tell a lie?
No.
No, right? Honey, do I look good in these pants? That's why Jesus, that's why Jesus wasn't married. So Jesus can't tell a lie. He's truth itself. And so humor has to have truth in it, because it can't be false, right? And to be God, it has to be truth. Now we got it. So there's this concept of joy versus happiness. So the Christian has this deep wellspring of joy, this knowledge of reality, this knowledge of the love of God, this knowledge that I'm a sinner, and there's one thing I've earned for myself. That's to go to hell. Everything else I've received is a pure gift. Salvation, grace, mercy, love, peace, light, life, friendship, laughing, the cubs, the whatever. It's all a gift from God. And so no matter what we go through, we have this deep wellspring of joy. The Christian can have the worst day of his or her entire life and have this deep wellspring of joy, knowing that the Father will take care of us, the Father will pick us up, the Father will save us from this muck, right? The Christian does not always have happiness. You know, happiness is being up, smiling, laughing all the time, you know. The Christian can have a bad day and be down, but at his or her core realize he's got this one. That's the difference between joy and happiness, right? So I like to use the example of the Christmas ham that my mother makes, right? You know, so I go home for Christmas, my mom makes this ham, and I eat more ham than a human should eat, and I'm very, 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 very happy. You know? And then about 4 hours later, I'm no longer that happy. But the fact that I go home and I'm with my family to celebrate the birth of our Lord who came among us to show us how much he loved us and to teach us right living, well, when I go to midnight mass, I'm joyful. And 4 hours later, still joyful. That's the difference between joy and happiness. Make sense? So humor has a fundamental ingredient which we would call joy, not necessarily happiness. So we can be slapstick, we can be goofy, and a lot of times when we're perceptibly experiencing that joy, we can get a little silly and get a little giggly. That's cool, but the giggles fade and the sense of humor remains. Okay? So even people that aren't funny can have a great sense of humor. Cool? So, Jesus's key to humor. A sense of the absolute and the relative. This is Jesus' key to humor. A keen sense of the absolute, the unchanging, the objective, and the relative. The passing, the changeable, the mutable. Or another way we could put that is perspective. Jesus, because of his sense of humor, had a better perspective on reality than anybody who's walked this planet. If you don't have perspective, you don't have humor, okay? So here are some examples of a little bit of Jesus' perspective in the Gospels. Luke 18, to those who have too simple a definition of the good, Jesus says, no one is good but God alone. Oh, well that's a different perspective. To those who are too inclined to separate good from evil, Jesus says in Matthew 13, let the weeds and the good grain grow together until harvest time. Hadn't really thought about it like that before, Jesus. Luke 12 says, to those who believe good fortune is permanent, Jesus says, fool, this very night your life will be demanded of you. Okay, so again, we're not like, fool, he said fool. Right? But it's a perspective shift. Jesus has this sense of humor, this perspective of reality. Speaking of perspective, St. Thomas More, you all know St. Thomas More? Remember he was, he would not sign the Act of Supremacy, making the king in England the head of the church, but he wouldn't speak out against the king either. And so he was up in his cell and they were trying to get him, come on, you won't sign because you don't think the king really is the head of the Church of England. I will never say anything against my king. Come on, just say it. Never. So they couldn't convict him. So one day a guard came up to his room. Hey, I'm coming to you as a faithful Catholic to a Catholic priest. I need your counsel. What is it? Well, they want me to sign the Act of Supremacy, and I need to know whether I should or not. And Thomas More said, no, you shouldn't. Why? Because he's really not the head of the church. Gotcha. So they convicted him on that, and so they were going to cut off his head. So being led up to the gallows, knowing his fate, St. Thomas More said aloud, Lord, help me climb up. I can manage the trip down by myself. That's some pretty good perspective, right? The fundamental requirement for humor is incongruity, okay? But with appropriateness. So a thing that shouldn't be happening, but in fact does, that's the thing that makes something funny. So the classic example, maybe they're not allowed to do this anymore, probably not, but I remember when I was in high school, at like the homecoming rally, the football players would all dress up like cheerleaders. You know, they'd use balloons in certain ways and They would wear skirts and do a little dance. Why is that funny? Because they're big, burly football players, not cheerleaders. It's not supposed to be like that, so we kind of giggle. Or the, I remember being in Mass one time when I was like 10, and the guy in the pew in front of us farted. A fart in church? Now that's funny. But there has to be an element of appropriateness to the humor. You know, so a lady falling down and hitting her head on the pew in church is not supposed to happen. That's incongruous. But it's not funny. A rattlesnake in the refrigerator, when you open up the door, rattlesnakes don't go in refrigerators, but it's not funny, right? So it's incongruity with appropriateness. Divine humor also has incongruity. Something plays out a way that it shouldn't, or a way we don't expect. And so divine humor is God acting in ways that human beings don't expect. And the Bible is full of a divine sense of humor, a way we think something should play out that doesn't play out that way. And if we think about it, our own lives are full of divine humor. So maybe some of you are sitting in this room tonight going, yeah, I never would have imagined myself sitting in this room during a Cubs game listening to a priest talk. There was a time in my life where this would not be the thing I would have chosen to do. Right? And I think that's good fodder for prayer, something we can go back and think about a little bit. That's a very good prayer exercise. Where has divine humor been active in my life? Where did God act in a way that I didn't expect him to? So humor is not a personality trait, right? It's not as if some people are just born funny and some people aren't. Being funny is a personality trait, but humor is not. There are funny people. There are some people who remember a joke better. There are some people who tell funnier stories. Maybe you are this couple or you know this couple where, like, maybe the wife will start the story and she'll go, oh, Henry, you tell the story. You're much better at telling the story than I am anyway, right? That is a gift. That's a talent. But humor is a decision. We decide to have a sense of humor about life. We decide to look at reality with a Christian perspective. Humor is a muscle that can be exercised so that we can get stronger with it. Make sense?
Yep.
Proverbs 17 says, a cheerful heart is good medicine, but a downcast spirit dries up the bones. Gerard Bessier says, the one without humor, even if he is the Pope, does not know God. Wanda Nash, I have no idea who that is. Does anybody know who that is? Well, whoever Wanda Nash is, she says, our insistence upon being serious with God heavily limits our experience of the Godhead. So I think of it this way. Maybe you don't do this, but I do think there is a good segment of our Christian Catholic population that when we go to pray, we put on what I would call a spiritual tuxedo, right? So we get all dressed up, and then it's time to pray. And rather than just talk to God as a friend or as a brother or as a truly as a father, we kind of make up some prayer, especially if we're not in the routine of praying. Oh God, almighty and powerful, not just of Oz, but of the whole universe, who in thy benevolence didst deign to createth me a sinful worm out of nothing. You know, like, we get this idea that that's how we pray, in this very formal tuxedo kind of way. We need to take off the spiritual tuxedo and realize that it's a true father who wants a relationship with us. Not just a landlord or a king. He is those things, but he's truly a father. Humor makes us self-aware. And self-knowledge is a supremely Christian virtue. Self-knowledge is the root of humility, right? So remember, there's false humility, and that would be like, anybody know Julie Herman? You know, the one of the cantors and the choir director here? Doesn't she have like one of the most beautiful voices you've ever heard in your entire life? Yeah, she's got this amazing, she could be like an opera star. And if Julie were to say, oh heavens no, everyone looking at me and me getting the spotlight and all that music at Mass, no, I really shouldn't do that. I'd prefer to be humble. That's not true humility, because God has given her a wonderful, beautiful gift. And so that's self-knowledge. Sometimes it means taking a step back, but sometimes self-knowledge means taking a step forward. So that's the root of true humility, this self-knowledge. So now I have a poem to read you. I did not want to read this poem, but Father Kotnik forced me to read it. This poem was written in a little magazine in the year 1939. It's called Your Parish Priest. If you are trying to find the kind of a priest, like the kind of a priest you like, you needn't put your clothes in a grip and go on a long, long hike. You'll only find what you left behind, for there is really nothing new. It's a knock at yourself when you knock the priest. It isn't the priest, it's you. You say he talks money each week. That's the only sermon we hear. If every church member were just like you, would the church debt really be clear? The parish is made by those not afraid, lest somebody else get ahead. When a few do the work and the rest of you shirk, no wonder the parish is dead. So support the church and your priest. Please remember this saying too. It's a knock at yourself when you knock the priest. It isn't your priest, it's you. Father Kotnik, everybody. How long do you think this should go tonight? Would 9 be okay? I'm kidding. I feel like I should tell another joke, though. Okay. So there was this young boy thinking about the priesthood, and he wanted to become a Jesuit. There's a lot of Jesuit jokes, okay? And so he went to the Jesuit novitiate, and he drove in these big, huge gates, and he saw this beautifully manicured lawn, and there were fountains on both sides, and he drove up the long drive to see this huge, beautiful building, and he went inside, and he saw his own room furnished with everything that he would ever need. He had this wonderful steak dinner in the Jesuit refectory. Then they went to evening prayer in the chapel that was filled with marble and gold leaf, and they said, "So, what do you think?" And he said, "If this is poverty, bring on chastity." Okay, I'm going to try to fly through some characteristics of humor. Humor brings people together. For example, Cana. Again, we hear the story of Cana, and we're not slapping our knee trying to catch our breath. But God acts in a way we don't expect. That's the divine sense of humor. Humor is not naive. Jesus knows what he's about. Humor gives. It reveals the heart of the truly human. Humor dispels darkness. Ever been in a crummy mood or having a bad day or something, and a humorous person comes around you and all of a sudden you're not in such a bad mood anymore? Yeah. Humor never forgets the hungry. It considers others. So remember the widow at Nain, where her son was dead and Jesus raises him and gives him back to his mother? Yeah. That's a divine sense of humor. You don't expect somebody to show up and raise a dead person back to life. Right? That's divine humor that considers other people. Humor sets bound souls free, brings about resurrection. Humor accuses the haughty. It slashes pride. So the example I thought was kind of like stupid, but I remember in high school, I was on the tennis team, and I never won anything ever. I was a horrible tennis player, just terrible, terrible tennis player. But I did win one match. And so I was like really bragging to my friend, and we were eating tacos, right? And I was just so full of myself. Oh, you should have seen me. I took him down, it was great. Blah, blah, blah. And my buddy Jeremy Hogan says, hey, Baki, you got a bunch of lettuce in your braces. That's like a perfect moment. Humor slashes pride. Humor chips away at the established and the comfortable. Again, some perspective. What's really important in life? Being established and being comfortable? Humor points to something greater. So Aristotle, which I don't have to write on the board, Aristotle said that the characteristic that makes us truly human is our risibility. So that's from the Latin verb ridere, to laugh. Aristotle says our risibility is what makes us human. I don't want to offend anybody here, okay? But we're kind of getting into a culture that believes animals are people, you know? My dog is happy today, my dog is lonely. He looked at me with that look and I just knew what he was thinking. I bet there's some of you people out there that even believe your dog laughs, okay? Your dog does not laugh. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. You've never met my dog. Risibility is what makes us distinctly human. We can laugh, which points to something greater than ourselves. Humor is satisfied with the simple. So I got to say this, one of the people in my life, probably in yours, who has the greatest sense of humor of anyone I have ever met is Monsignor Dan, right here at St. Thomas, right? That guy has a great sense of humor. And if you ever golf with him, you should play him for money. But at the same time, as you go, he says this every single time you're on the golf course, you know, Johnny, you can't just worry about the game. When you're out here, you have to look around at God's beautiful creation too. Don't just look at the ball, but look at the trees and look at the blue sky and look at the clouds. Yeah, if I was shooting a 120, I'd be looking at the trees too. I have a feeling I'm going to be in trouble for that one. But anyway, humor doesn't take shots at other people. Humor is satisfied with the simple. Humor is not self-seeking. It transforms insult into kindness. Okay, so I got to see if I can... St. John Vianney was... one of the greatest saints of our tradition, a very holy man, but really, really struggled in school, was not a great student. And all of his life, John Vianney was able to laugh heartily at his own lack of talent. Even when he was a student for the priesthood, John didn't take himself too seriously. A professor who examined John before his ordination was exasperated with seeing his dullness in the classroom, and said, this young boy is a complete ass. What can he possibly accomplish? Vianney overheard the professor and replied, if Samson, armed only with the jawbone of an ass, could kill 1,000 Philistines, imagine what God could do with a whole ass. Humor makes people feel good. Jesus loved to tell stories. Jesus loved to use his sense of humor to make people feel good. Humor always invites. So true humor has no inside jokes. It calms the storm. It's a form of service. We can ask ourselves, is our perspective of reality helping other people? If we have this perspective of the world is going to hell in a handbasket, okay, maybe it is. What does that do for anybody? Humor is long-suffering. It bears wrongs patiently. So we had this like diocesan steering committee meeting for the year of mercy that's coming up, you know, starting December 8th, that Pope Francis called. And so the method of the meeting was to kind of go through all the great spiritual works of mercy and corporal works of mercy of our Catholic tradition that so many students now, and especially in the past, really memorized and had seared into their brain. And we went through all of them and, you know, burying the dead, okay, got it. Visiting the imprisoned, got it. Feeding the hungry, no problem. Clothing the naked, okay. Bearing wrongs patiently. And the whole room went, ooh. How do you do that? That's a tough one. And I always think of the airport when I think of bearing wrongs patiently. Boy, lots of Christians do not bear wrongs patiently in the airport. Or I think of, this is like a particularly American thing I experienced in the seminary in Rome. I'm just going to tell you a few facts, okay? This podium is made of wood. The lights are on in this room. Italians budge. I just told you three facts. It's not a judgment call. But Italians cut in line. They budge. They have no sense of lining up. Zero. And so, like, we'd be in line at St. Peter's, and an Italian would cut in line, and some guy would have to be like, oh, no, you didn't. I am an American man, and you're not budging me. Right? That would be this huge thing. Okay, yeah, out of justice, they shouldn't be budging you in the line, but a good sense of humor bears wrongs patiently. A good sense of humor has a little perspective. Okay, well, that just cost me 4 seconds to get into the basilica. Jesus had his humor to the bitter end, all the way on the cross. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Another characteristic of humor, it's for all ages and all times. So on the all ages part, again, I got to point to Monsignor Hermes and like his sense of humor is for all ages. He can get along with anybody, you know. There's like preschoolers that just go nuts when he walks in a room, you know. And then junior high kids, high schoolers, get along so well with him, all the way up into the nursing home. Humor is just appealing to everybody. It's for all times, and one of our great saints tells us that people are always taking themselves too seriously, so there will always be a need for humor. You could imagine that in America's seminary in Rome, some guys could begin to take themselves too seriously, you know? And so we had this, there were times, you know, where a particular guy would just get really either full of himself or, you know, we're studying for the priesthood, this is serious business, maybe if I get straight A's and I memorize all of Latin, I'll be in the diplomatic corps one day, or, you know, just like different stuff like that. And so we had this spiritual director who's one of my life heroes, Monsignor Lyons. He's since gone home to God, but he would walk down a hall in America's seminary in Rome and go, caw! Caw! He reminded us not to take life too seriously. He would get in the elevator with us standing like this, and the doors would close, and he would go. So this is what Jesus feels like in the tabernacle. Good humor reminds us never take ourselves too seriously. And humor is a relationship builder. So I'm hoping to do a little bit of humor in the Bible. But it's important to remember that humor is culturally conditioned. So have you ever seen like a British comedy? Yeah. Now maybe you're weird and you find it funny. But I've seen British comedy and I'm like, okay, where is it? Where's the funny thing? But I remember like learning Italian, they would tell us like little jokes in Italian, and you know, like your mama jokes, ever heard about those? Yeah, if you have, shame on you. But there's a whole series of like Caesar jokes, like Julius Caesar jokes, you know, and it'll be like, why did Julius Caesar cross the Rubicon? To eat sardines. So even at the same time, like we live at this in the same historical period of another culture, we don't really get their sense of humor. That's actually a sign that you have learned a language and you've been enculturated, is once you start finding funny what they find funny. And so we got to go back to like first century Palestine for Jesus, and then even longer for the Old Testament. There are humorous lines and humorous things that are kind of lost on the modern reader or hearer. But I'm gonna do this. I hope it doesn't eat up too much time, but I want to go through the whole story of David and Bathsheba. Because I think Old Testament wise, this is, there's kids back there, earmuffs. At the turn of the year, when kings go out on campaign, David sent out Joab along with his officers and the army of Israel, and they ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. David, however, remained in Jerusalem, which is already a jerk move. But one evening, David rose from his siesta and strolled, listen everybody, okay? He rose from his siesta and strolled about on the roof of the palace. From the roof he saw a woman bathing who was very beautiful. Uh-oh. David had inquiries made about the woman and was told, she is Bathsheba, daughter of Eliam and wife of Joab's armor-bearer, Uriah the Hittite. Then David sent messengers and took her. When she came to him, he had relations with her at a time when she was just purified after her monthly period. She then returned to her house, but the woman had conceived and sent the information to David, I am with child. Uh-oh. David therefore sent a message to Joab, send me Uriah the Hittite. So Joab sent Uriah to David. When he came, David questioned him about Joab, the soldiers, and how the war was going, and Uriah answered that all was well. David then said to Uriah, go down to your house and bathe your feet. That doesn't mean bathe your feet. Uriah left the palace, and a portion was sent out after him from the king's table. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the royal palace with the other officers of his lord and did not go down to his own house. Uh-oh. David was told that Uriah had not gone home, so he said to Uriah, have you not come from a journey? Why then did you not go down to your house? Uriah answered David, the ark and Israel and Judah are lodged in tents, and my lord Joab and your majesty's servants are encamped in the open field. Can I go home to eat and to drink and to sleep with my wife? As the Lord lives and as you live, I will do no such thing. Then David said to Uriah, stay here today also. I shall dismiss you tomorrow. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day. On the day following, David summoned him, and he ate and drank with David, who made him drunk. But in the evening, he went out to sleep on his bed among his lord's servants and did not go down to his home. The next morning, David wrote a letter to Joab, which he sent by Uriah. In it, he directed, place Uriah up front where the fighting is fierce, then pull back and leave him to be struck down dead. So, while Joab was besieging the city, he assigned Uriah to a place where he knew the defenders were strong. When the men of the city made a sortie against Joab, some officers of David's army fell, and among them, Uriah the Hittite died. Then Joab sent David a report of all the details of the battle, instructing the messenger, when you've finished giving the king all the details of the battle, the king may become angry and say to you, why did you go near the city to fight? Did you not know that they would shoot from the wall above? Who killed Abimelech, son of Jerubbaal? Was it not a woman who threw a millstone down on him from the wall above, so that he died in Thebes? Why did you go near to the wall? Then you in turn shall say, your servant Uriah the Hittite is also dead. The messenger set out, and on his arrival he relayed to David all the details as Joab had instructed him. He told David, "The men had us at disadvantage and came out into the open against us, but we pushed them back to the entrance of the city gate. Then the archers shot at your servants from the wall above, and some of the king's servants died, among them your servant Uriah." David said to the messenger, "This is what you shall convey to Joab. Do not be chagrined at this, for the sword devours now here and now there. Strengthen your attack on the city and destroy it. Encourage him." When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband had died, she mourned her Lord. But once the mourning was over, David sent for her and brought her into his house. She became his wife and bore him a son. But the Lord was displeased with what David had done. No, that's a big one. Uh-oh. That's a line you don't want written about you in the Bible. The Lord was displeased with what you had done. Maybe I'll start using that in confession from now on. And that is all I can remember. The Lord is displeased. I would have short lines. The Lord sent Nathan to David, and when he came to him, he said, "Judge this case for me. In a certain town, there were two men, one rich, the other poor. The rich man had flocks and herds in great numbers, but the poor man had nothing at all except one little ewe lamb that he had bought. He nourished her, and she grew up with him and his children. She shared the little food he had and drank from his cup and slept in his bosom. She was like a daughter to him. Now the rich man received a visitor, but he would not take from his own flocks and herds to prepare a meal for the wayfarer who had come to him. Instead, he took the poor man's ewe lamb and made a meal of it for his visitor." David grew very angry with what the man had said to Nathan. "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this merits death. He shall restore the ewe lamb fourfold because he has done this terrible thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are that man." Right? There's a little divine humor story. There's a few, all the way back at the beginning where we saw that woman bathing on the roof. We're like, is this a Bible story? Seriously? Even if we've heard it. So that's a divine sense of humor. God acts in a way we don't expect. There's another one of those we'll touch upon. Noah. Okay? So we're culturally conditioned to find certain things humorous. Like 6,000 years ago, people who heard this story about, there was a guy, and he built a huge boat because it was raining so much. And every animal in the world got on the boat, and he saved them all, right? I'm not downplaying the story. I'm not saying, you know, that I'm like a faculty member at Loyola in Chicago, and that's a story for a simple-minded people, and it's just allegorical and really didn't happen. You know, that's for you to decide, but it's a funny, humorous story. There was a guy who got swallowed up by a big fish and lived in its belly for 3 days. That's a funny story. Hosea and the Psalms also recount that God pursues humanity. To people 6,000 years ago, that's funny, right? Like, so here we are, like, walking around in a field, and the guy who, like, made everything wants us. Now that's funny, right? It's humorous. He's acting in a way we don't expect. Then in the New Testament, these are some things that, I don't know this, but biblical scholars say these things would have been very funny to the hearers of Jesus. Lighting a lamp and putting it under a bushel basket? That's so silly. Building a house on sand? A father giving his child a stone when he asks for bread? Apparently that was funny. And then, remember when Nathanael meets Jesus and he says, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" And then Jesus says, "Truly, this man is truly a son of Israel." That's like a little repartee in the Bible. Like I think we picture all Bible stories, no matter what, with British accents and Charlton Heston. "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" Like it's like some big profound thing. No, it was a jab, it was a joke. And then Jesus is like, this guy gets it, right? Here's some more divine humor. God acting in ways we don't expect. Jesus ate with sinners. He spoke with women. He was born in a stable. He rode a donkey as a king. he preached that the kingdom was already present. So I think sometimes we skew our vision of the New Testament even a little bit, and we think that all of Jesus' hearers were Pharisees, like everybody that encountered him. Like when he spoke with women, that everybody was like, oh, how dare he? This is terrible. But he had all kinds of crowds following him going, all right, I'm mopping up with this guy spilling, right? They liked what was going on. Humor had to play a part in how famous Jesus became. And then we have to just read aloud the most humorous event that has ever happened. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of the bystanders who heard it said, look, he's calling Elijah. One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down. Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. Very early, when the sun had risen, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb. They were saying to one another, who will roll back the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb? When they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. On entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a white robe, and they were utterly amazed. He said to them, do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, the crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Most humorous thing that's ever happened. We wouldn't expect that to happen. We wouldn't expect that would be the ending to the story, but it is, and that's going to color the Christian perspective. It's been so long, and we've heard the story so many times, we forget about those first Christians, those apostles, those disciples who walked to the shores of the Sea of Galilee with Jesus. They ate with him, they drank with him, we've established, they laughed with him, they listened to his teachings, they sat at his feet. Then they saw him with their own eyeballs. They saw him get sentenced to death. They saw him get humiliated, beaten, spat upon, abandoned. They saw him crucified, and they saw him dead. Then they saw him walking and talking and eating and drinking and, as we established, laughing again. And that totally, pardon the expression, rocked their world. That created the Christian set of goggles. That created the Christian perspective, the Christian sense of humor. That's the way we view reality, is that even a crucifixion has a side B. Cool? Okay. I feel like we should have another joke. So there was a Franciscan, a Dominican, and a Jesuit who got transported in time to the birth of Jesus. So there's Mary just cradling baby Jesus in that little stable, and Joseph is standing by. And the Franciscan says, with tears in his eyes, I am so moved that God is born in such poverty to unite himself to us who are so poor. And the Dominican said, truth has come to teach us. And the Jesuit leaned over to Joseph and said, have you thought about a Jesuit education? Saints were not gloomy. Saints are funny people. Sin makes us gloomy. Sin makes us somber. Sin makes us sad. But holiness makes us humorous. With great self-knowledge, the saints had great perspective. So there's this French theologian who says, joy is the most infallible sign of the presence of God. When you see a joyful person, that's the best sign that God is with them. I remember, so I have this aunt who was on like some committee for hiring their pastor. She's a Lutheran, and so Lutherans have a little different system than we do. Catholics, you get to find out in the Observer who your new priest is going to be, whether you like it or not, right? But Lutherans have a call process or an interview process or something, and they brought in, I remember she heard talking about, they brought in some candidate who was like perfect on paper. He had like 3 doctoral degrees and just all this experience and everything. And so she was talking about how after he left, he looked great on paper, but he didn't seem to have joy. And so ultimately, the congregation, that particular one, kind of like passed on calling him to be their priest. Joy, not academic degrees, is the most infallible sign of the presence of God. For example, St. Lawrence, you know, who they roasted alive to martyr him. He's a martyr deacon. They were grilling him to kill him, and he said, while he was being burned alive, flip me over, I'm done on this side. True story. St. Augustine, who said, you know, who battled with some sexual temptations, he prayed, give me chastity, O Lord, just don't give it to me now. I think this is my favorite line of the all the lines I found. St. Thomas Aquinas, who's among the top 3 greatest minds Catholicism has ever seen, they thought he was dumb just because the way he looked. And so 2 of his Dominican brothers said at the window, hey Thomas, get over here, you gotta see this, there's a flying cow outside. And Thomas very seriously walked over and looked out the window, and they laughed at him and called him an idiot. And he said, that may be true, but I would sooner believe that cows can fly than priests would lie. Thomas also said, it's against reason to be burdensome to others, showing no amusement and acting as a wet blanket. Philip Neri, who's one of my favorite saints, they called him the clown of Rome. He was a wonderful priest, went around the city of Rome, really ministered to Rome's poor, and they were getting downtrodden and depressed, so he had this beautiful beard, and that was kind of like the fashion back then. So beards are coming back, I think, actually, but at that time it was like anybody who's anybody had a sweet beard. He shaved half of his beard off just to get people to chuckle. That's funny. Then I just want to, there's so many great, remember good Pope John, now St. John the 23rd? There's some pretty good John the 23rd stories, so I want to share a couple of those with you. Somebody asked him, how many people work in the Vatican? And he said, about half. When they brought him out for his papal inauguration mass, like his first mass as the Pope with his big crown, and they still had all the trappings at that point. So the workers were carrying him out on the big velvet like papal throne. So they hoisted him up and he leaned down and he said, I weigh twice as much as Pius the 12th, so we're going to pay you double. One of the things he loved to do, it was a little bit safer back then, but he used to sneak out, they actually called him Johnny Walker, that's one of his nicknames. He would sneak out of the Vatican and just visit different prisons or pizza shops or just get to know people. And so once he popped in on the Sisters of the Holy Spirit, and Mother Superior came to the door and opened it and was so shocked, she just stuck out her hand and said, hello, I'm the Superior of the Holy Spirit. And Pope John said, wow, I'm just the vicar of Christ. Somebody said to him, I hear people don't work at the Vatican in the afternoon. He said, no, the Vatican is closed in the afternoon. It's the morning when they're not working. And on seeing him after he was elected, he was a big guy. So you remember how in the Room of Tears, you know, the guy who's elected Pope goes to that little room in the Sistine Chapel and breaks down, and that's why they call it the Room of Tears. Well, they have three cassocks, small, medium, and large. Well, the large one didn't fit Pope John when he was newly elected, so they had to custom make all of them, but he still had to come out on the balcony. So it was cut up the back and like safety pin. So he comes out, you know, you can see this on YouTube. He comes out and does the whole like papal thing, you know. God bless you, Peter and Paul, everything. And the curtain closes. So on seeing him, a lady exclaimed, "He's so fat!" And he heard her and leaned over and said, "Madam, the papal conclave is not a beauty contest." And here's my favorite one. So before he was the Pope, he was the papal ambassador to France, which as far as the diplomatic corps at the Vatican goes, that's the most prestigious position. So he's at this super fancy party in Paris, and a woman shows up to the party who's very scantily clad, a very short dress and lots of things being exposed, you know. And so an observer leaned over to him and said, "Excellency, aren't you concerned that all the guests will be looking at this woman?" And he said, "Not at all. They're all looking at me to see if I'm looking at that woman." Humor brings about courage because it brings about perspective. So we remember Thomas More, when he was up on the gallows, right before he died, uttered those famous words, "I die the king's good servant, but God first." It brings about courage. It deepens our relationship with God because it helps us gain greater perspective on reality. Reality itself, God. Blessed Julian of Norwich says, "God wills that we seek him merrily, without heaviness and vain sorrow." God wants you happy to have humor. And just the way the media portrays him and stuff, you wouldn't think this quote would be from Benedict XVI, but it is. God says to us, don't take yourself too seriously. Even Pope Benedict has a pretty good sense of humor. I remember when he came to the United States of America and had a meeting with all the bishops downstairs in the basement, the crypt of the National Basilica. And so his job before he became Pope was the prefect of the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, or, you know, the watchdog to make sure everybody was teaching the right things and not getting off track as far as our Catholic faith goes. And there was a particular bishop in the United States, and they'd had like a 20-year battle. This bishop was always getting called in. They were always having fights and everything. But in the sense of also, the media portrayal of bishops fighting is not fair. It's not like politicians. It's like brothers. So bishops disagree, and disagree strongly, but with charity. So he comes, and he's sitting there, and they chose like the oldest bishop and the youngest bishop to be able to address the Holy Father at this thing. So this bishop he'd had like a 25-year relationship with got up and asked his question, and Pope Benedict just said, "Thank you, Excellency. I remember all of our discussions." And then he had like this Pope giggle, and it was like the coolest thing I've ever seen in my life. Humor welcomes, humor heals, and humor is practical. So this is a true story of one of the books I was reading, the author's buddy. This happened to the author's buddy. There was a police officer who was like tucked away in one of those little speed traps, and so he got this guy speeding, and so when he got up to the car, the police officer said to him, "I gotcha. I've been waiting for you all day, and I gotcha." And the guy said, "I'm sorry, I was getting here as fast as I could." So humor can actually be practical and get you out of some stuff. Okay, so humor is a good thing, but how can I have humor or joy if I am fundamentally and deeply unhappy? Sadly, This is the state of a good number of our Christian brothers and sisters. The first thing I would say is we need to remember what we've been talking about, perspective. No matter how bad it is right now, God is on your team. Second, we remember the cross. This is our only hope. Third, the martyrs. We're not alone. Lots of people have gone before in very, very terrible and difficult situations. God got them through, and they were no different, no better, no stronger than the graces He gives us. And lastly, an attitude of gratitude. This is what psychologists will tell you, or counselors, or therapists, or however you want to say it. An attitude of gratitude goes a long way. So there are five things we could do. The first is create a laundry list of blessings. That's a big deal. What's God done for me? Second, review the day. Where was God today? Third, ask to see my own shortcomings. Where did I fall? And where did I cause my own pain? Because it's probably not just God sticking it to you. Ask for forgiveness. And then fifth, the last one, ask to do better tomorrow and go to sleep. Darkness actually helps us appreciate the light. This is one of the things that just kind of like blows me away in talking to folks who are so grateful for the alcoholism they went through, for the cancer they went through, for the depression they went through, because it's helped them have this perspective and appreciate the light so much more. So an attitude of gratitude goes a long way. We can't expect to be up all the time. St. Francis de Sales tells us, when difficulty comes your way, laugh in its face, and remember you are in your Father's arms. When difficulty comes your way, laugh in its face, and remember, you are in your Father's arms. Just one more question. Do you think God loves some people more than He loves others? Yeah, I figured you'd say that. It's a medieval question that we now think is like insane. It's a crazy question. Could you agree with me on this one? God has a special place in His heart for fools. I think He does. I think when St. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians to be a fool for Christ, he meant it. I'm not going to belabor this, but there's that sermon St. Francis of Assisi gave to birds. He told birds to open up their beaks and bow down to the divinity, and the birds listened. That's crazy. Who does that? I sort of want to tell another joke. I'm trying to wrap this up. I'm trying to land this plane. Okay, here's a joke from a Lutheran pastor, okay? So this is a Lutheran joke that we have to appreciate as Catholics. A Lutheran pastor is asleep one night when the phone rings. The fire department is calling to say that someone is about to jump off a roof. The pastor throws on his clothes, jumps in his car, races to the house. When he arrives, a firefighter points to the man on the roof. "Don't jump," yells the pastor. "Well, I'm going to," says the man. "I've got nothing to live for." The pastor asks, "What about your family?" The man says, "I've got none." The pastor says, "What about your friends?" The man says, "I don't have any." The pastor pauses for a long while and then says, "Well, I'm sure we could be friends. I'll bet we have a lot in common. "I doubt it," says the man on the roof. The pastor thinks, "Well, do you believe in God?" The man says, "Yes, I do." "See," says the pastor, "we have that in common. Are you a Christian?" "Yes," says the man. "So am I," the pastor delighted. "Are you a Lutheran by any chance?" "Yes, I am," says the man on the roof. "I'm a Lutheran pastor," says the pastor. "What synod are you?" "I'm Missouri Synod." "Never mind, jump." All of us in this room, I think we get this pretty well, this crowd. We're all called to evangelize. And evangelization, remember, means to facilitate an encounter with Jesus Christ. It means to be the bridge, to get out of the way, to be the bridge in facilitating an encounter with Jesus Christ. Not to be the best teacher, the best apologist, the best preacher, the best know-it-all, but to facilitate that encounter. Arguments are not as good a tool as humor. People will see us. Why are you always smiling? Because of the resurrection. Because of those Christian goggles we inherited from our brothers and sisters 2,000 years before us. The world is starving. The world is literally starving for Jesus Christ. And Jesus, this is the good and the bad news. He's got no other options but you. You're it. And he doesn't need you tomorrow. He doesn't need you to spread the gospel when you've got a little bit more knowledge. He doesn't need you to spread the gospel when you're a little bit holier and you finally kick that sin you've been trying to kick. He needs you tonight. He needs you when you walk out of this room. And the best thing you can offer the world is your Alleluia goggles. Goggles that say, yeah, we've got problems, but I'm a Christian, and I happen to know the end of the story already. And it's a wonderful ending. We're Catholics, and that means we have a particular ethos, a particular way of looking at reality. It means we drink, but not too much. It means we dance, but not too much. It means we work, but not too much. It means we play, but not too much. It means we practice all of life's joys with moderation. We see reality from a heavenly and not an earthly perspective. As Hilaire Belloc put it best, wherever the Catholic sun doth shine, there's always laughter and good red wine. At least I've always found it so. Benedicamus Domino. 8:30. You want one more joke, or you want to go home? Okay, last joke. Let me do this long one, just because I think it's funny. A Catholic priest, a Baptist preacher, and a rabbi served as chaplains to the students of a college in the Midwest. The three friends would get together several times a week for coffee. One day someone commented that preaching to people isn't really all that hard. A real challenge would be to preach to a bear. So they decided to do an experiment. They would venture into the woods, find a bear, preach to it, and attempt to convert it. 7 days later, they gathered again to discuss their experience. Father Flannery, who had his arm in a sling, was on crutches and had bandages on his face, went first. Well, he said, I went into the woods to find a bear, and when I found him, I began to read to him from the catechism. That bear wanted nothing to do with me and rudely began to push me around, so I grabbed my holy water and baptized him, and he became as gentle as a lamb. The bishop is coming out next week to give him First Communion and to confirm him. Reverend Smith spoke next. He was in a wheelchair and had one arm and both legs in casts. Well, brothers, I went out and found a bear as well. And then I began to read to him from God's holy word. But that bear wanted nothing to do with me, so I took hold of him and began to wrestle. We wrestled down one hill, up another, and down another until we came to a creek. So I quickly dunked him and baptized his heavenly soul. And just like you said, Father, he became as gentle as a lamb. We spent the rest of the day praising Jesus. The priest and the preacher both looked down at Rabbi Stein, who was on a stretcher. He was in a full body cast. The rabbi looked up and said, looking back on it, circumcision may have not been the best way to start. thanks again for coming. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.